Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the talk of Nowcasting Financial Quiz with Deep Learning Techniques with Mauro Pelucchi. Mauro Pelucchi is a senior data engineer and big data scientist. He currently works at MSC Burning Glass as a head of global science and is also responsible for the design of real-time labor market information system on skill requirements for CDFOP. So, hi, Mauro Pelucchi.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah. Have you heard everything I said?
I cannot hear you. I cannot hear you. If I understood from your eyes, I needed to introduce myself.
Yeah, sure.
No? Okay.
Do you now hear me?
Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. So, can I introduce myself?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you. So, sorry, I'm very sorry, but I cannot be there with you. Unlucky, the second time after 2020, also in 2022, I cannot be in Bratislava for this beautiful conference. I sent a video recording about my talk, and also all the material, so the slide, the notebook, are already available on GitHub repository. So when you want, you can download the data, download the notebook, download the slide, and so on. So in my video, I will speak about data and how to build OData from the scratch, because I think it's very important that everyone, every researcher, every data scientist, every that need to work with data have the possibility to go to the web with a bot and download the data. So I think it's all. I leave the stage to my video, sorry. And I hope that next year, in 2023, I can join you in presence in Bratislava.
Okay, so thanks.
Welcome to everyone to this session of PyCon SK 2022. I'm very happy for me it's impossible to be in Bratislava with you today, but however, I really appreciate the invitation from PyCon SK 2022, and I really appreciate the invitation from Richard, and I needed to say thank you to the team of PyCon 2022, because I repeat, it's for me it's a pleasure to present my session today. So I think I already shared the screen, so I am starting to present my session, but before to start, I want to introduce myself, of course, and what I will present. So my session is about ingestion. So what I will cover in a few minutes, it's something about the creation of a dataset when you don't have data. Of course, it's impossible to say you don't have data in 2022, because you know, from the internet, we can see a lot of data. So I will show you some methods, some methodology to take really the real world, to scrape this data from the web. So when you don't have data for your research, for your company, if you want to start a new business, you can scrape a visitor from the web and create a new database. So my session is shared also, so the slide of my session and the notebook that I will use in a few minutes, it will be shared also on GitHub. So take care about the presentation and the slide, because I put a couple of links where you can find the presentation and also the notebook of this session. So let me to go ahead from the slide. So In this slide you can see the link to the repository where I will put all the material. Give me a couple of days to fix all the bugs, all the typos, and so on. And also during this presentation, I will use Google Collaboratory to show you. So it's something that you can really use in a few minutes. Of course, to scrape data every day, every minutes, every second is different to create one dataset for a single shot research. And I will show you why. And also in a few minutes, I will also present a real project where I scrape data from the web, really my team scrape data from the web, and create a database to support some question from our stakeholder. So let me to introduce myself. So I am Mauro Pelucchi. I am from Italy, and in my life I run a lot of work. So first of all, I am an employee of Lightcast. In Lightcast I work as data scientist and senior big data engineer. So I lead my team. My team is the global data science teams of Lightcast, where we take care about the collection of global data, the normalization of the data, the cleaning, because our goal is to create a new model, in some case machine learning model, deep learning model, in some case traditional model, to release insight about the labor market. In fact, for Lightcast, I also take care about a couple of very big projects for the European Union, in particular the real-time labor market information system of skilling requirement. And I will show you something in a few minutes about this big project. I also am a teacher, I'm a lecturer for universities. I collaborate with University of Milano Bicocca in statistical degree courses since 2017, and also with the Faculty of Engineering in University of Bergamo, my city is Bergamo, where I teach in courses about computer programming, mobile technology, architecture, and so on. Why this mix of stuff? I will show you something in a few minutes. So let me to start from agenda of today. So I will speak about scraping versus crawling. So why we have two different methodologies. I will show you something about the methodology to build a dataset from the web data. I introduce also the concept of phantom browser, because when we navigate the internet, the web, to scrape this data, what we need is to try to emulate the behavior of a normal user. I will introduce one technique. Of course, we have a lot of different language, different techniques to scrape data. Today, we will see one type of phantom browser and also one type of language to query the web page. And I will show you why you need to query the web pages in a few minutes. And I will show you with a practical notebook. So I will leave to you also this practical notebook. When I teach to my student in University of Milano Bicocca, my students are coming from engineering courses, statistical courses, computer programming, but also economics. So it's not a notebook for computer science nerd. No, it's something that everyone can use to create their own data set. And also we speak about ethics, because this data are on the web for free. I don't know. So we will speak about these ethics at the end of my presentation of today. So let me to start from the result. So I repeat, so I also lead the technical part and the methodological part of a couple of big projects for CEDEFOP and Eurostat. What are CEDEFOP and Eurostat? CEDEFOP is an European agency that take care about the vocational training. It's based in Greek, in Thessaloniki. And what we do for CEDEFOP is try to release insight about labor market. Eurostat, I think you know Eurostat. Eurostat is the agency of the European Union that take care about statistics. So it's something that try to aggregate every data from the National Statistical Institute and try to release a common data set about all the European Union. So, for Eurostat, we maintain the system called the Web Intelligent Hub that takes care about the collection of the job posting data, the normalization and the application of a machine learning model, and the release of the data. So, what we do every day, really every second, also now for the European Union, is try to navigate the web. So let me to emulate what we do and what we will see in a few minutes. So we try to navigate the web. As example, we can go to the famous employment agency or job board or web or job search engine website. In this case, I'm using a job advertisement website where I can look something. And what we do is try to scrape this data. Of course, we do this for a lot of different sources. When we download the data, we try to apply machine learning model to normalize the data. The final result is this one. So, which is a public tool. You can, it's called Skillovad. You can put in Google, for example, Skillovad, and it's quite easy to find these web pages. So, in this tool, we release data about the labor market. So, for example, if I want to see the skill trend, oh, let me to go to the occupation. It is more easy to show. Okay, if I want to know if my question is okay, what are the more requested occupation in web job posting in Europe? So I can select the country. For example, I go to Slovakia. Because so we are at the PyCon SK. So as you can see, I can select this country. I can see that the more requested occupation is something about the professional, associated professional, service, and so on. I can select the professional. In this case, it's based on a common taxonomy called ISCO. As you can see, I can see the distribution of the job posting in different groups, search engineer, professional. Of course, the first group are the ICT professional, and so on. Of course, I can go in detail about this data. For example, I can go to the skill across occupation, for example. Also, in this case, it tries to select one country. So, SK, I can go to the working with a computer, go to the engineering and manufacturing. I can select, for example, the electronics and automation. I can see the more requested occupation with this type of skill. And I can go ahead a lot of time. As you can see, when you have to start to scrape data to create a data set, you need a question because in the web we have a lot of data, so it's difficult to download every data from the web. So, sorry. So, of course, you need a question to start, and then you need to think about the data where you can find this data, and then you can use the notebook to download the data. And the notebook I will show you in a few minutes. So, let me to return to the slide. So let me to start about the terms of data ingestion. So of course, the goal of data ingestion is to create a new data set from zero. So you need to select the source. Of course, this work from the web usually is real time because you know the data in the web are quite quick, so they change very quickly. So you need to scrape this data when the data are present because tomorrow you don't know if the web page it will be available or not from the web. So of course there is techniques to jump this constraint, but it would be very expensive. So the data ingestion from the web usually you can call it also web data ingestion is real time. Of course, you have different techniques. You have crawling and scraping. Crawling would be the more famous because you know a crawler is a bot, is something that go to the web and try to download everything, really try to index everything. One of the more famous crawler is the Google bot that ingest everything from the web and normalize the page across the Google standard, the schema.org, try to do every stuff. But of course, also Google as a final question is to try to build an index to index everything in from the web. So it's quite different from run or scraping activity. Scrolling, I repeat, is to download everything. The results are unstructured data, so you have a bunch of web pages. Crawling is quite different because I will see you in a few minutes. Scraping is about structured data. So it's not about the start. The start is the same. You start from web pages. But the result of crawling is a bucket full of text, HTML, and so on. If you start to run scraping activities, it's something at the end you will have a database with rows and columns. So you start from the web pages full of text, images, banner, and so on. You make some cut and paste, and at the result you have rows and column. So in my example, I will use very few data, so you can base your data, you can put your data on an Excel file. So rows and columns, I repeat. So it's completely different crawling and scraping. So what are the main tasks of run web scraping? You need to identify pages, identify the sources. Of course, for example, in my example, there are a lot of job advertisement website in the web. So it's very difficult to download everything, and we cannot see that we download every job posting. Of course, we download a lot of data, but of course, you need to identify the pages that you need. You have to identify and understand the structure of the pages. Structure is about HTML and CSS. And then you have to navigate, to simulate the user behavior to structure the data, because your final goal is to build a structured data set. So let me to go. Why we need? Because we have a lot of good results from web scraping activity. We can build a data set from zero to support researchers, to support marketing analysis, to support my pricing team. For example, what we do is to try to start from data that the people, the employers put to for some purposes, in this case to hire talent. What we do is to try to transform this data in something different. We transform this data in analytics, and we base our business on this analytics. So it's something completely different. So as you can see, there are a lot of different topics. Of course, what I suggest to you, don't start to download everything. Start from a question. Start, okay, I want to analyze the phenomenon, something, or so one specific phenomenon. I don't know, the election politics in Italy, something related, I don't know, to the Ukrainian war. So I want to start from a specific topic. So you need, I repeat, identify the source, identify the pages, understand the structure, create the bot. Only at the end you push the button and load the data. So think about your result that you want. So you can have different tools to create your web scraper. You can use a visual tool. I put something, I don't love this type of methodology, but are very useful for non-technical people. So I put something are you need to pay, for example, in Port.io, Mozenda, something are free, for example, octopart.com. In this case, are a specific tool to create a web scraper. Of course, I need to stay are based on the browser, so you can use, and you don't have to install something on your personal computer. Other tools are framework, for example, Ratch is a famous framework, you know, Adobe started in 2004, if I remember well, from Natch. So Natch is one specific tool to create crawler, in this case, Solr, HTTPTrack, StormCrawler, and so on, are tools, are framework. So you need to install also the framework on your machine, on your server, so could be specific for computer engineer, for computer science professional. So I see you two different world. So the visual scrolling and scraping tool for not technical people and framework for technical people. In the middle, we have custom code. So there are libraries for every languages, JSOUP for Java. For example, we use JSOUP, Scrapy with Python, Beautiful Soup, that is a very nice library with for Python, or Selenium. Selenium is a Phantom browser. I will show you in a few minutes. Today, our exercise will be based on Selenium, but it's not a tool for web scraping, but it's a tool to emulate the user. So Selenium is built to create tests for, you know, for a website. And we will use Selenium not to test the website, but to create an automation that emulate the user, navigate on the web pages and download the data. So we will use Selenium for something other. So in this slide, you can see the repository where we put all my code and also the slide of the presentation. So give me a couple of days to reset myself, create, check everything, and then we can go. So what we will do in a few minutes are start from IndiegoGo. I will see you something. With a Python script based on Colab, we will create or data set, or specific data set. So the tool is based on the browser. So let me to see you something. So I switch to the browser. Okay, so IndiegoGo is a public website where people try to put their project and run crowdfunding campaigns. So as you can see, we have a lot of different projects with different topics, from digital tools, comics, film, electronic stuff, and so on. So what we will run is a scraper to download this project, to create a data set where we will have the title, the description, the image, the start date, what they are doing, and so on. So the data set that we will build is based on this tool. Of course, so identify my source, because what I want is to investigate this market about crowdfunding. So how to start to scrape? I have a browser. What I have to do is to emulate the user. So if you go to the IndiegoGo.com with your, I suggest you to use Chrome. I don't want to make some, I don't know, I don't know to show you our browser. In this case, Chrome is very good to run this type of, Chrome or Firefox are two very good browser to start this type of exercise. So in your browser, you have the developer tools, you know, it's the starting point. Why? Because you need to investigate about the structure of the page. So as you can see, if I go to here and I don't put nothing, I have the full list of projects on IndiegoGo. How many projects they have? I don't know, a lot of projects, because I also need to click this show more button, as you can see. So I can sort by most funded, because I need a fixed sort to be sure to not download a project two times, but also to download every project. So as you can see, I have my start link is this one. So my bot will be start to download data from this link. Okay, how to investigate? So identify my source. Now I have to investigate the page, and I have a browser. So if I go to the developer tool in this position, I can investigate on the structure of the page. So I go here, I Chrome open this tab. I usually prefer to have this type of visualization with page and code. And I have the inspect tool. I can click here, go, for example, to the title. As you can see, I can identify in the page the position of the title. As you can see, I have a lot of stuff. Let me to explain a little this tab and this position. As you can see, I have the elements tab where I see the code, the HTML code, with the reference to the current web page. So it's what I see in the web. So the Selenium scraper will be based on this type of code. Of course, I have also the sources that are, one second, where is the sources? So I have something which of my browser, I think is related to the connection. So in this page, let me to go to another page. No. In this page, you have the source, the original source. Of course, you know, the HTML code that you receive from the Indiegogo server is not the same that you see in the page. Why? Because there are a lot of JavaScript, Ajax component, API and so on that modify, update the page during your navigation. So I will use Selenium because in Selenium you can really emulate what the user is doing. So with the inspect tool, I can identify the piece of the page to cut and paste. So what we will do is to identify the portion of the page, copy the portion in one sheet of Excel, in one database, if you have a lot of data. As you can see, it's quite easy to identify that this specific element of a page has a specific class, for example, or specific tag, some specific attribute. So what we do is to try to use this specific element to create the bot. For example, if I go here, I see that there is this discoverable card minus title. It's something that in our mind, in my thoughts, is related to the title, and I am expecting the title. So let me to try to query this data. To query this data, I will use a specific engine. I cannot use SQL, if you know SQL, to query over pages. In instance, I will use the selector. So if you are here and digit command F or control F, if you are a Windows-based system, you have this specific bar to query by string, selector, or ispath. So one topic about ispath is beautiful, it's very complex. Selector is beautiful and less complex. Is the reason that I will speak about selector today. So I try to query. So I put a dot, and I will show you a dot in a few minutes. I try to remember discoverable card minus title. As you can see, the Google component is identifying 25 elements. And I can try to check. As you can see, if I go down with the button, Google is showing what I need. So if I need to download this title, I can base my bot on this query, and I will have all the 25 titles. Why 25? Because it's something is not related to the scraper, and then I have 3 per 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 3 per 8, 24, and 1 is not related. So I need to address some issue during my scraping activities, but it's very useful. And I can go ahead, for example, I can, for example, try to identify the category. As you can see, I am using Indiegogo because it's quite easy to understand what we are doing, because Indiegogo in this case are using a very good CSS to apply style on the page. So as you can see, I have another specific class. It's discoverable card minus category. could be related to the category. Let me to try. So, 25. I go down. Okay. Are my categories. So, what I do is to try to identify the structure. So, let me to return the slide for a few minutes. So, the browser is the base tool. With the browser, we can open the page, surf to the internet, identify the structure, and so on. Of course, we need to identify two types of elements. The tag, so the element of the web page, usually the element, you know, start with or this type of structure. We can use the ID of the component, but our usually my scraper are based on the class because the class is something that the designer usually will be reused in the web page. So if also you have a different device and so on, the class is something that is very good to create your scraper. So let me to go. So how HTML code is written in web pages? You have the start of the tag, the end of the tag, and some attribute. We can use every element of the HTML code to create the scraper. We can use the tag to query. Let me to give you an example. If I put here div dot the class, I can see only 24. Is what I need. 3 per 8, 24. So if I use the tag dot the class, my query is with more precision. So very good. I can use the attribute. I can use everything. So let me to go ahead. In the slide, you have all the path, so you can redo this exercise a lot of time. But let me to explain a little the query language. So for the query language, we are using CSS Selector. Why? Because it's very simple. It's very easy to use CSS Selector. You have these specific syntax. So you can use element dot class. If you query by dot class, you the browser will return every element with the class. If you query with the element dot class, the browser will select before the each element of the page with the tag that you specify, and then filter the data by the class. So you will increase your precision. You can also use different elements. Sorry. You can also use a different element. For example, you can put the tag, the element, and the cookie bot. So if you put this type of syntax, you can select only the element with a specific ID. The ID should be unique in the page. Usually is unique, not every time is unique. But of course, it's another type. So if we have two type of syntax, this one and this one, you can escape the data. You don't need other type of syntax. Of course, query selector has other syntax, more complex, other type of query. I put in some case this reference. My suggestion is start from this one and this one. If you need to be more, if you need to increase your precision, you can use this relation by parent and child, as you can see. So in this case, I will select all the element A that are child of one element div, that are child of one element discoverable card. So it's something to increase your precision, but it's something that usually I don't use every day. So with these two type of syntax, really you can create your scraper. So I will go to the notebook in a few minutes and I will speak about the notebook in 5 minutes. So my session is going to the end. What we will do in the notebook is to start from IndiegoGo, see, download the HTML code, try to parse, use CSS selector, so the query that I ran a couple of minutes ago, and download the data. Of course, in the notebook, there are a lot of stuff. I will show you only the first part of the notebook. In the notebook, you have also big exercise. So starting from the first page from IndiegoGo, download all the data, create a link of links, go to the other page with a lot of detail. So this page, in instance, so you will emulate the click and you can go to this page specific for the project and download all the data. So in the notebook, you will have a different section. So let me to go now to the code. So you will have all the code shared as soon as possible in GitHub, in my GitHub repository. So how is structured the notebook? So in the notebook, you will have a practical way to create your first Selenium instance. There is some questions, so you can use a notebook to make some partition about the download of the data. I will use Pandas, so the main Python libraries for data processing, to download the final dataset. You will have, so my presentation of today will be end at this session, at this title. Of course, in notebook, you will find something more technical, for example, how to download the detailed pages, like I mentioned a few minutes ago, how to download every images, how to use API, because one other way to scrape data is to try to see what are the communication between the web browser and the server, and try to not emulate the user behavior, but to emulate the machine behavior. It's something that you can do. In this case, Indiegogo is a good example. I really say thank you to Indiegogo because it's very good to for my teacher purpose, for my teach purpose. And of course, there is something because in some case, some organization doesn't want that you scrape data. So if you need to jump some web firewall and so on, you need a proxy to either your connection, and there is some practical tool also in this section. So let me to start very quickly about the notebook. First of all, you need to install the library. So this specific code is for Google Colab. If you want, you can adapt this code for your local machine. In the Git repository, give me one day to reset myself, and I will put also something specific for Windows, Windows or Mac or Linux. I need to import the libraries. Of course, I import the libraries related to Selenium and so on. And first of all, I create the Selenium browser. So something about what you see. So as you can see, I'm using a Chrome-based Phantom browser. You can switch to Firefox and also other tools. Here I'm putting something. I need to specify the user agent. Why? Because I don't want that in the Google stop me to scrape it. So in this case, I will present my Phantom browser as this user agent. Why this user agent? Because if you go to your browser, to the network, for example, I can see that my browser is, where is? Which one? So you can take from this section, for example, or you can go, you can Google the more recent user agent, and you can take the user agent from this place. It's another technique. First of all, I need to create the web driver. As you can see, the object WD is in this case a Chrome driver Phantom browser. First of all, I go with the get method, so WD.get, go to the Indiegogo web pages, and I can make a screenshot. Why I needed to make a screenshot? Because I want to observe that if my connection is from Italy, since I'm using a Google Colab, so Google Cloud environment, is my session is appear from US. So everything is different. So as you can see, the format of the page is more little. The data are in English, in some case in my pages from my connection, something is in Italian language because I'm from Italy today. So it's very useful to use a screenshot to understand, okay, where I am now. And of course, in some cases, you can store the screenshot to inspect in the future these pages. As you can see, if I use wd.title, I can download the title of the web pages. Is what you see in your tab, for example, in your tab title. I go ahead. So there is some practical question. So if you go down in the notebook when offline, you can also try to resolve this question. So first of all, I need to translate the query that I run from my browser to this notebook. I will use this syntax. So find elements with by CSS selector. Of course, you can change the by to different elements. So you can use, for example, by ID, by name, by path, by tag name. What I see today is CSS selector, but you can use all of these different type of syntax to query the web page. So as you can see, if I put a discoverable title, the first page, if I reload my pages, is based on 3, 6, 9, 12. So I expect to find 12 titles, and what I see is 12. If I print the text 0 and text 1, I find something that could be equal or different. It depends by the sorting, of course. So please check every time what you are doing. So let me to go to the practical exercise. So what we need is to try to identify this part of the page. As you can see, I can go here. I can select this part, and you see that there is this specific tag called discoverable card. So what I can do is to try to go here, filter by discoverable card, and I find my project. Why is important? Because I can now create this specific method that for every project. So as you can see, list project is, or list, if I go here, based on 12, let me run to restore my notebook. As you can see, each element is a web element. So if I go to the first element, I can run another query, but the query now, so this query on this element of the list of element is not for all the pages, but this query where I am finding each element A is on this specific part. So if I restrict the scope of the query, it's more useful because my data are in or more at quality, of course. As you can see, I use every time this specific syntax because, you know, the designer are quite, have a lot of idea. And in some cases you can find card, but it's not the same as the previous. So it is a way to have more data and to not have any error during the scraping. So as you can see, I run the find element. The result of a find element is a list. If I found at least one element with this specific class, I will download the element. If not, I will leave the element blank. Of course, I will have issue about the quality. It's another topic. So the goal of the web data ingestion is to create a database. The next goal is about how to increase the quality. So please split the scope of ingestion, create the raw data. Don't take care about the quality. Store everything. Store everything. Don't take care about the null. Don't take care about the format. Try to store what you find and also the raw HTML, because in the future, I don't know, you can extract more data if you want. Don't take care about the quality, because I repeat, the topic of the web data ingestion is to download everything in real time, because tomorrow the web page could be disappeared from the web. So download everything, cut and paste the element, in this case, the title, description, category, and so on. Don't take care about the quality. You also take care about the quality offline when you have time. First topic, download everything. As you can see, the result of this cell is about something very structured. I have the balance, category, the currency, the image. So it's I am starting from this page. The result is a list of dict. So very structured. Of course, I can move this code to a function, like in this cell, and I can run the function on the first page. But the question is how to end. You have a lot of different possibilities to end your scraper because the goal is not to download the first page. You can run the exercise manually. It's to download all the thousands of projects from IndiegoGo. So if you wanted to, for example, download the first 10 page, what you need is to run this code, but this one, on each page. And you have to emulate the click. How to emulate the click? With the click method. So Selenium is able to run your command on a browser. So if you identify the specific button, as you can see, in this case, the class is ICTA1, and I'm using this one to identify the button, you can click. You can click and then you can go ahead. When you have the final data, you can translate your dictionary to a CSV or to an Excel and you can download. So the final data are on an Excel file in this case, or you can put on your database, on your Snowflake, on your S3 bucket, on an AWS and so on. So this is what you need. So let me to go to the finish of my presentation. So, of course, you can also use different tools. So in my notebook, you will use Selenium, but if you want to create something in Java, you can use JSOUP with Selenium also. Scrape is another tool from Python, for example. Etix, it's possible to scrape data. So, first of all, let's speak about what you find on the web. Web scraping is a tool, not a crime. So it's possible. A lot of article sentences and so on permit us to scrape the public data from the web. You cannot. So you can also try to download the private page. So I think you need to speak about the purpose. Let me to explain, for example, my experience. What I do for business is to navigate the job boards, employment agency website, download job advertisement. What I can run is to create another job board, try to select the more monetizable job advertisement and create a new job board. What I do is to try to use this data that the people put to hire someone, to match demand with supply, and create analytics to help a decision maker, to help university to increase the occupability of your courses, of your student, to help the student to identify the best occupation based on your talent. So it's something different. So in this case, I don't have issue with my sources. Of course, I am polite. So I don't run a scraper every second. So I try to limit, okay, to respect my source, to respect my partner. Usually, I also try to ask, sorry, I am Mauro. I don't want to create for you issue. I want to download data to create this one. And we can also collaborate if you want, because if you want, I can download the data, apply my method, and return to you the data if you want. If you respect the data ownership, if you respect the privacy, if you respect the business of your page, it's not an issue. If you start to be in the middle, it's something that you need to take care. Of course, it's something that the source is not able to check in some case. It's in your thoughts, in your idea that you have to check if you can or not you can. Usually, I suggest ask for the data. I'm sure that in some case you will have some response from your sources. So I am finishing my presentation. So I really thank you for this opportunity. I am really happy to not be in Bratislava today because this is the second time. The first it was in 2020, now in our time. So I really be sure that next year I really want to be in Bratislava because it's a very beautiful city and I want to meet the beautiful person of PyCon SK. So really thank you and bye bye. Yes, now yes.
Okay, let's move to the questions. The first question is, scraping can sometimes lead to blocking of your server's IPs. Any tips how to avoid such situations?
Yes, it's a common situation for a lot of time. The web sources try to block you to scrape data by web firewall, for example, web application firewall. What you have to do is to try to rotate your IP addresses. How? You can build your own mechanism to rotate your IP address, or you can use virtual proxy. What I mean, you can buy or there is something open. So in the notebook, in the last session, you will see some open proxy, or you can buy something. There are in the web specific organization, but for business, provide you API to rotate your IP. In this case, you have two benefits. Of course, you be able to jump the web firewall and the traditional firewall. Second, if you need a specific IP from a specific country to scrape data from the country, for example, if you want to scrape data, I don't know, from China, it's very important to be in China because you have to need the right localization. You can also choose from this library the right country.
Okay, thanks. And the second also logical question is, how do you scrape data from pages with CAPTCHA protection?
Yes, it's quite difficult. So the traditional CAPTCHA can be addressed. Also in this case, you can develop your model because CAPTCHA are image in the web pages. So you can also download the image with an OCR technique or with a machine learning model. You can try to decode the CAPTCHA and it's quite easy. With the model CAPTCHA, for example, when the CAPTCHA asks you to solve a puzzle, to ask a question, to select the image, is more difficult. In this case, I think it's better to find our techniques, like to contact the source.
Okay, thanks. And the final question is Selenium compatible with Python's async.io?
Yes, I think so. I don't use async.io, I'm honest. I think we are not compatible, but I have to check. Why? Because in my mind, async.io is very important to run stuff in a synchronous way. I think also to parallelize the scraping. And usually I'm using different techniques. For example, I suggest you to investigate to the possibility to put your scraper in a Lambda function, for example, in AWS, or in a container, in a Docker container, because in this case you can run your stuff in a parallel way, for example, with a Kubernetes cluster.
Okay, so thanks. This was all the questions, and thanks for your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And I hope to see you in Bratislava next year.
Okay, bye.
Bye bye.
Mikrobit je programovateľný mini počítač, ktorý ti dovolí prepojiť informatiku s kreativitou. Dá sa programovať veľmi jednoducho a ovládať tak, aby robil presne to, čo chceš. O pár minút sme zvládli rozsvietiť vlastný obrázok na displeji a chvíľu sme už obrázky diaľkovo prepínali druhým mikrobitom. Mikrobit má v sebe aj super vychytávky, ako sú tlačidlá, senzor pohybu, kompas a teplomér. K mikrobitu ale môžeš pripojiť množstvo ďalších vecí. Tu programujeme, aká animácia sa nám má ukázať na LED pásiku. Ja som na ňom naprogramovala dúhu. Teraz programujeme podľa nôt kohútika jarabého. Najlepšie na mikrobite je, že si viem vytvoriť napríklad blikajúceho robota alebo gitaru, ktorú ovládam tak, že ňou zatraciem, alebo futbalovú bránku, kde mi mikrobit počíta, koľko gólov som dala, alebo kúlové svietiace topánky a tisíc ďalších vecí, ktoré ešte len vymyslím. Mikrobit je hračka, ktorú schováš do dlane a vytvoríš z nej čokoľvek. Tak čo s ňou spravíš ty?
Každých 60 sekúnd si 28 000 ľudí predplatí službu Netflix. Odošle sa 197 miliónov e-mailov, stiahne sa 414 000 aplikácií a ukradne niekoľko tisíc hesiel. Na internete sa toho deje veľa. A všetko najdôležitejšie sa dozviete na Živé.sk. Živé.sk. Technológie ľudskou rečou.